The fastest animal in the world is the peregrine falcon. When they dive bomb, they reach speeds up to 400 kilometers per hour, and they adopt a particular pose where their wings aren't completely pulled in and they aren't completely open either. They're some way in between. They're like this cupped kind of configuration. And even during level flight, these falcons can reach up to 100 kilometers per hour. And if you watched our YouTube short on our video the other week, you'll know that pigeons can also do that. And that's during level flight, not during dive bombing. So that's insane. Anyway, the pose the falcons adopt where its wings is kind of halfway between open and closed also ties into their ability to maneuver while they're still dive bombing. So they can literally dive bomb so fast, and then they can even turn and not just shoot down, but turn and even climb up out of a dive bomb. And that makes sense when you think about it, because it is literally high school physics in play here, where as it accelerates, its kinetic energy increases. And we know that changing the altitude through falling converts potential energy to kinetic energy. So when you have all this kinetic energy, if you were to guide yourself back up, the kinetic energy will shoot you back up and be converted into potential energy again. And obviously there is some loss there. So this all comes from the falcon's body shape to begin with, and the insane speed it reaches during dive bombing. So in this podcast, we're looking at the aerodynamics of a peregrine falcon during dive bombing and how it gets to such velocities. So to do that, we're looking at a paper called Aerodynamics of the Cupped Wings During Peregrine Falcon's Diving Flight. So you can find it just here. And this is open access, so you can find it in the link below. And these researchers did some CFD, and we'll get to that, but the really cool thing is the experiments they did to figure out the exact geometry of the falcon during dive bombing. So to figure out what shape this peregrine falcon was in when it was dive bombing, they trained a peregrine falcon to jump off a dam and dive bomb down. So this is pretty cool. Back in figure one here, this is the dam here, and just dive straight down. And they placed these cameras around this dam to capture and recreate a 3D image of the bird, so a CAD geometry. And during this dive, the researchers identified three distinct phases of this flight, and it's kind of expected. So the first part was the acceleration part, the second part was constant speed, and the third part was the bird decelerating. So in figure one, we see the experimental setup, and once they had the models, they made them out of PVC. So they made these little bird models, and one for the bird in the open wing configuration and one for the bird in the cupped wing configuration. So we see two different configurations here as they're going down. So for the CFD, I'm a little in two boats about whether or not I think the CFD is good or not. On the one hand, they did some really good things. On the other hand, they are missing some important parts. But let's go through their setup and then discuss the good and bad parts. So first of all, they put the CAD models in a geometry, and we can see the CAD models in figure two here. So this is what's called the open wing configuration, which is on the left. The cupped wing configuration is on the right. And the open wing configuration is pretty much where they pull their wings completely up, so their wings are in line with the rest of their back. The cupped wings are kind of like the wings are extended down a little bit and cupped around his body and standing off a little bit of a way. And then in figure four, we see the domain where they put this bird in this general box in the CFD. So from what I can tell, the box seems to be big enough. If anything, I think maybe the inlet and outlet are a little too close to the falcon, but the walls seem okay. So the inlet in particular, perhaps if they put that a bit further upstream, but we'll see how it goes with their validation and that. So they had around 8 million cells in total, and they had a really good boundary layer setup. So they had a Y plus value of 0.2, which is really good. And because they use the Spallet Alamaris terminus model, this is a good value to have for this Y plus. And interestingly, because they are looking at a flying object, I guess the Spallet Alamaris terminus model would be well suited here. I mean, the model was developed for airfoils, so I guess it should be okay for birds as well. I don't know. I would be interested to see how different terminus models do fare in this situation. But anyway, let's move on to something that's really impressive. So one thing they did was that they used the exact same terminus intensity in their CFD as they have in their wind tunnel. And this is exactly what you're supposed to do. Not many do it. And that is because it is a very important distinction, because if you are using a different terminus model, the point at which the boundary layer transitions to turbulence will definitely change. And then that will change how much lift and drag you're producing and whether the flow is attached or not. So it is a very important parameter, and it's good that they incorporated that into their CFD to get their CFD as close to the experimental results as possible. So good on them for also taking that into account. Now, for the birds, they tested this at 22.5 meters per second, because that was the maximum velocity that they clocked their falcons in real world, diving off of the dam. And based on the bird's length, which is 400 millimeters, the Reynolds number is 587,000, which is arguably in the transitional regime still, especially considering that the thermal intensity level was just 0.04%, which is really, really low. I mean, most wind tunnels, they're around like 0.6%. So this is like less than 1/10 of that. So one thing that's really funny is that because this Falcon only dived at 22.5 meters per second, the authors set their CFD to incompressible, which is completely acceptable. But the funny thing is that when a Falcon dives at 400 kilometers per hour, all of a sudden the Mach number is over 0.3, which is the rule of thumb on when you should change from incompressible to compressible assumptions. So in real life, when the Falcon dives at top speed, it starts to experience compressibility effects. That's really cool. In fact, they're pretty much the only animal in the world that can say that. Well, they can't say that because they can't talk, but if they could talk, then they'd be saying that they're the only animal in the world that could reach compressible situations. So that is really cool. So the authors say that this simulation was steady, and this means that they used a RANS model, I'm quite certain, because they also have a Thomas model, which is for RANS. So we've covered the good bits of the CFD so far. Let's now cover the bad parts. So they took the experimental data, and they said that the experimental data experimental coefficients match the CFD coefficients, but they only give the drag coefficient comparison for the cupped wing configuration. So we can't tell how well the CFD matched the experiments in the other coefficients and configurations. So we don't know how the drag and lift coefficient was for when the bird had open wings, or the lift coefficient when it had cupped wings. It's just the drag coefficient for the cupped wing configuration. And in this particular case, the CFD drag coefficient was quite close to the experimental drag coefficient, being only 4% off. In addition to this single comparison, the authors didn't do a grid-independent study, so we don't really know if the CFD had converged to a stable solution yet or not, and how that would affect the lift and drag coefficients. So overall, there are good points to the CFD and there are bad points to the CFD. I think overall, the CFD is pretty good. I would say that it's around 6.5 out of 10. They also have some FlowVis data for the CFD presented below, which from this validation I think is definitely trustworthy. They also give some force coefficient data for the CFD, which I think we should take with a grain of salt because we don't really have that much validation data, as I mentioned. It's just the drag coefficient for one configuration and that's it. And I should say also, if you want to learn how to do OpenFOAM, which is a great and free CFD software, but it's hard to learn, take our course and link below. We go through it in baby steps. But let's get to the results now. So for the lift and drag coefficient in table 3, let's go down to that table. Here we go. We have a comparison between the two different wing configurations for the CFD. So we have the open wing, closed wing, lift coefficient, drag coefficient. And one thing that's really interesting is that when the Falcon cups its wings, the drag coefficient drops by like 20%. And on the flip side, the lift coefficient also increases by about 20%. So there's this two-way swing that greatly improves the aerodynamics of the bird when the Falcon cups its wings as opposed to completely opening it. In addition to that, the general drag coefficient of this Falcon is in either wing configuration is quite low. They're like around 0.07 or 0.09, which while isn't nearly as low as like an airliner, it is much lower than most birds in general, and they usually have about a drag coefficient of about 0.3 to 0.4. So the fact that this Falcon has a drag coefficient of like 80% lower than a typical bird is probably one of the major reasons why it can dive bomb so fast. There's just such little resistance on it compared to regular birds. And another thing that is quite interesting is when the Falcon is dive bombing, it does produce quite a bit of lift. So the lift coefficients are around 0.1. Now, I don't quite understand why it would want to produce lift while diving, because that would increase its drag even a little bit and hence reduce how fast it can go. So if the bird was not producing any lift, then the drag coefficient might drop a few percent and that would allow the bird to go even faster than 400 kilometers per hour. So I'm not sure what the practical reason is for the bird to produce lift while dive bombing. Maybe it's a stability reason. Maybe it's for safety. Like if it's already producing a little bit of lift, it can then control its path more. I don't really know. So if you have any ideas why it would want to produce lift when it's dive bombing, let me know in the comments below. But either way, the cupped wings greatly improve the Falcon's aerodynamics, both in lift and drag, the coefficients. So in figure 7, we have a cool bunch of plots showing an array of different information ranging from the pressures on the surface to the wall shear stresses, to the streamlines and lambda 2 plots. First of all, let's look at the surface pressures, and let me zoom in a little bit here so we can see a little bit better. There we go. That's good. So the open and cupped wing configurations create slightly different amounts of, slightly different in terms of the pressure distributions on the front and top of the bird. So for example, when the wings are open, there is this lower pressure on the top surface of the bird. So around here, it's like pretty much where shoulders are. And that kind of makes sense because this is how wings usually produce lift. But there is also slightly higher pressure on the bird's throat, so just underneath here. So this is likely a reason why the Falcon has a lower drag coefficient when cupping its wings, because it doesn't have as much of a higher pressure underneath its throat, pushing it back, and hence dropping the pressure drag. On the other hand, the cupped wings have a greater leading edge surface, and that experiences that results in a higher pressure around here when its wings are open. So that region is not good for drag. Looking at the wall shear plots, we see that when the Falcon cups its wings, there is a lot lower wall shear stress over the rear part of the birds. That reduces the skin friction drag of the bird. So we can see the tail here, it's a lot more blue than when the wings are open. And also the neck seems to have a lot more like streamlining going on when the wings are cupped. When the wings are open, there is this ring of low shear stress around its neck. And we don't get that on the cupped Falcon. And if we look really closely, so let me zoom in a little bit. The open wing configuration actually makes the neck get necked a bit. So there's, it's now like this little bulge here for the chin, as opposed to when the wings are cupped, there's no bulge here. So that means for some reason in the Peregrine Falcon's anatomy, when it opens its wings, the neck shrinks, while when it cups its wings, it becomes much smoother and remains about the same diameter as the head, the throat section. Now, this wall shear plot also has something called LICs, which stands for line integral convolutions. In essence, you can think of them as like surface streamlines. And they show where the flow goes. And when the bird is in the open wing configuration, a lot more flow is channeled over the top of the wings. So we can see that these LICs, let me zoom in a little bit here. These LICs, they sort of get pushed towards the inside and up over the bird. Whereas that doesn't happen for when the wings are cupped. The flow in this region is much straighter. So these wings are redirecting the flow quite a bit. In the next plots down, we have the streamlines over the wing regions. And there is a major difference between these two configurations. So when the wings are open, there is actually flow separation underneath the wing near the root, which is really surprising to me because I would have thought that simply through evolution, a bird's wings would have mostly attached flow. Maybe in this configuration, this happens and the negative effect of the separation has on the lift production and the drag doesn't stop it from catching its prey enough. So maybe it's acceptable. It's kind of like saying though, it's like saying something shocking. Either way, I find it quite weird that the flow is separating underneath the bird's wing when it's open near the root. But when the bird cups its wings, we don't get any of this flow separation. It's all sweet. Now in the next couple of plots, we see the Lambda 2 isosurface behind the bird at these two configurations. So let me quickly explain what this is. So first of all, an isosurface is when you like cut out the part of the flow that meets a certain criteria. So for example, let's say you wanted to get everywhere in the flow where the velocity is greater than 2 meters per second. So then you will get rid of all of the regions that don't meet that criterion and only keep everything above 2 meters per second. And you can do that with any quantity you want. That is an isosurface. You can do it with the velocity, pressure, vorticity, even like thermokinetic energy or even dissipation rates. If you can measure it, you can then specify that threshold and get that isosurface to only capture that amount of the flow. In these configurations, we have the isosurface of the Lambda 2 criterion. So what is the Lambda 2 criterion? So Lambda 2 is a metric we can use to determine if a vortex really occurs or not. So this is a little bit of a tricky thing to understand, but essentially just because you have vorticity doesn't mean you have a vortex. You may not. It really could just be that you have some vorticity, but that is just simply due to how the flow is rolling off the wall and no vortex is actually present. So to more accurately define whether a vortex is there or not, aerodynamicists have been coming up with a bunch of different metrics. The most commonly known ones, at least today, is the Q criterion and the Lambda 2 criterion. They are both very accurate, but the Lambda 2 criterion is a little better. Having said that, they both give like the exact same result 99.999% of the time. So the Lambda 2 criterion is a way to determine if a vortex is really present or not. And bringing all of that back to this figure, These researchers have two plots. The one on the left is for the Falcon with its open wings, with the isosurface of lambda 2 criterion above a certain amount. The one on the right is exactly the same, but for the Falcon with cupped wings. Now, I should note that I don't know the exact threshold they use for this lambda 2 criterion, this isosurface, and that is actually an important point to note. So when you do your research, it might be experimental, it might be CFD, regardless, when you are going to have a limited salute resolution in your data, CFD is almost always finer, but either way, because you only have a discretized grid, you'll always incur some errors, especially when you use derivatives. As such, noise is introduced into your results, and when you process them, you start to get these little parts where you get errors and noise. So for example, in this particular case, if you were to calculate the lambda 2 criterion for the entire domain, you might get some very small points here and there that suggest that there are tiny vortices present, but in reality, that is just noise or error. So when you make an isosurface, you want to set the threshold such that you remove a lot of that noise, but keep the important stuff still. So for example, in these plots, we can see very crisp isosurfaces down here. And there aren't little bits of random isosurfaces here and there. So that tells me that the researchers increased the threshold to get a crisp figure, which is completely fine to do. As long as you just use reasonable judgment, it makes sense to do that, to get rid of that noise. So that whole explanation is what these two figures are about. Now let's compare them. So both of these figures show three main vortex structures, one off each wingtip and one from the tail. And that makes a lot of sense, but while they share these features do differ quite a lot between the two Falcon configurations. First of all, the wingtip vortices are much bigger when the bird cups its wings, and strangely, that actually makes sense because when the bird cups its wings, for some reason, they actually extend more than when it opens them. It's just that they are extended down and cupped more. So on this right figure, we see these wingtip vortices extend much further downstream and they're much bigger. So you'd expect that these cupped wings should produce more normal force than the completely open wings because they have larger, like their wings are extended more, and hence they have larger wingtip vortices. And that definitely goes a long way in explaining why the Falcon produces more lift when cupping its wings than when they are open, as we covered earlier. Now, in addition to cupping the wings, in addition to the wings that are cupped, increasing the wingtip vortices size, they also reduce the tail vortex size as well. That to me suggests that when the Falcon is cupping its wings, it greatly changes where it's producing the lift. It produces a lot more lift here on its wings and less on its body when its wings are cupped. Whereas when its wings are open, it produces more lift through its body and less through its wings. So the Falcon, as with every bird I'm aware of at least, uses its body to produce quite a lot of lift, and it can change how much it's producing lift from what I can tell here. And if we move down a little bit more, we see that there were some wake planes downstream of the bird, and the vorticity is plotted here. So the shape of the vorticity fields is very different between the two wing configurations, as you'd expect from what we just covered, and the fields match the shapes you'd expect too. And finally, in figure 9, we see a really cool plot. So we see the flow field downstream, and it's cool to see that when the Falcon is cupping its wings, the large winged vortices travel downstream a lot and induce so much flow around them and downwash them between them. So you can see all this flow being sucked up with these arrows, how they're pointing, and then being pushed, funneling all the way down between them. So they're greatly manipulating the flow around the bird in general. And with that, we come to the end of our podcast. This was a really cool one because I was quite surprised with a few of the findings. One was that the Falcon produced a decent amount of lift while dive bombing. I didn't expect that too much because that would also increase the drag, but maybe it is due to stability or due to maneuverability perhaps, or due to safety reasons, I don't know. Another interesting result was that when cupping its wings, the drag coefficient dropped and the lift coefficient increased a lot. That is noise. And another interesting result was that somehow cupping its wings resulted in effectively having larger wings than when it was opened. So with that, we come to the end of this podcast. And if you liked it, make sure to hit the like button and the subscribe or follow button, whichever platform you're on. And if you want to learn how to do open foam, check out our course in the link below. We have other CFD courses as well. And if you want to do your experiments and make sure that density of air is kept track of throughout the day, because the density of air changes throughout the day, and that introduces a lot of error into your data that you can't get rid of and even don't even know what it is. So to solve this problem, we make an instrument called the Atmosphere Hawk, which you can find in the link below, and I'll see you next podcast. Peace out, amigos.